Now, here is the requirement. He says here, verse 6, if any be blameless. Now, the thought here in this word blameless is a man that, it doesn't mean that he's perfect, but it means that any accusation made against him is not true. That's important. Not that he's perfect, but when an accusation is made against him, he's blameless. That's the whole point. If any be blameless, it's too bad when somebody can point a finger at an officer of the church and say, that man's dishonest. That doesn't help the cause of Christ. I don't care how gifted the man might be with natural gifts. And if you can point to a man and say, that man's mouth is certainly not dedicated, his language is set. These are things, you see. He should not be guilty of these things. If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children. And the idea here, faithful children, means believing children. And if a man can't lead his own children to the Lord, he ought not to be an officer in a church. Now, don't misunderstand me. I recognize that today in many of our wonderful Christian homes, there is that son or that daughter that's away from the Lord, gives no evidence, and they're godly parents. Now, what Paul is saying is this. That man may be a wonderful man, and he may have had a wonderful Christian home, and he may not be guilty of anything that caused that boy or girl to turn from Christ, but he shouldn't be an officer in the church, because when he sits as an officer in judgment on somebody else, you see, it's so easy to point a finger at the man and say, well, what about your son? What about your daughter? What right have you, you see? So it's for the cause of Christ, the sake of the office that Paul's talking about here, you see. And he must have believing children, not accused of profligacy or unruly. Our translation says of riot. In other words, they ought not to be out on a protest movement carrying a placard. If they're going to carry a placard, it shouldn't be a protest, but a placard glorifying the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I do think there's a better way of getting a word around than that. I can't understand why somebody can't see that giving the word out on radio might be a little bit better than carrying one of these placards around today. We're sometimes misunderstood by that. Now, let me move along, because you see how practical this is. He says, for a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God, not self-will, not soon angry. That means not touchy. You know, a lot of us are touchy, and there are times, I guess, when all of us are a little touchy about something, but he's not to be touchy, not given to wine, not violent, not given to filthy lucre. That is, not covetous. And he says, now, bishop. Now, you see, as we said before in 1 Timothy, an elder and a bishop are the same office. You see, elder refers to the person. Bishop refers to the office. Because actually, presbyteros, the elder, it means a man, and I think a mature man, ought to be the office. And bishop here is episkopos, means overseer. That has to do with the office. Never was one man made a presbyter or a bishop in a church. Always several, you see. And this, I think, is the same office. I think we need to recognize that. Also, let me say that I do not believe that this man Titus went there and arbitrarily picked out men. I don't think he went there and just said, eeny, meeny, miny, mo. He didn't do it that way and pick this one and that one. I think these men were already elders, but now they are to be ordained. And now I recognize that some believe that this man Titus appointed them. But I believe that if he did that, then the church had to pass upon these men, and I'm sure that they did. I do not care to make an issue of that because I do not think it's that important for us today. But the important thing to note are the requirements for this particular office. And again, I must repeat, there never was just one. There always were the elders and the office of a bishop. And there were many of them, you see. Now, we're told here he's a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober-minded, just, and holy, and temperate. Now, these are the requirements of the man, and I'm sure that these are things that we're familiar with. And now Paul goes on to say, holding fast the faithful word. And I'd like maybe to change that just a little. Holding fast the trustworthy word according to the teaching, that he may be able to exhort in the sound teaching and to convict the gainsayers. Now, there were two things, therefore, that this officer was to do. One was he should be able to exhort, that is, to teach the Word of God. That is, I think, very important for us to see. And he also must be able to refute the heretics, if you please. And that's exactly what I think gainsayers mean here. He is to be able to do two things now. The positive side is to teach the Word of God, and he's to be able to refute these heretics that are around about him. And personally, I think that men who hold an office in a church should be Bible-trained men. They just can't be made like, you remember a few years ago in World War II, we had what was called, wasn't it called 90-day lieutenants? A man was made an officer in some short course, and they needed him and put him through in a hurry. And, of course, they came up with some rather peculiar second lieutenants in those days. But, very frankly, the same should apply in the church. You remember Paul said, lay hands suddenly on no man. You're not to have a man converted one night and then have him up giving his testimony the next night and making him an officer the third night and making him then an evangelist on the fourth night and the pastor of a church on the fifth night. We move like that today, and I think it's very unfortunate for the church. A man should be able now to stand on the Word of God.